So the question now would be, if you could have that kind of freedom, why would you want this kind? And that's the next sort of challenge. So you might feel, and some people do, that's not enough. This kind of freedom is called freedom of spontaneity. And its maxim is, I can do what I want. And you can put in for do, want, right? I can do or want what I want. That's freedom of spontaneity. Whatever you want to do, you can do. This kind of freedom was called freedom of indifference. And its maxim is, I could have otherwise. Could have done otherwise is this, right? I wanted to pick up my hat, and I did. But I could have done exactly the opposite. Even though all the causal antecedents of my action were exactly the same. So here's, remember the forking path? The agent stands on a forking path. You've got freedom of will. Even if you go down fork A, you could have gone down fork B, even though absolutely everything prior to your choice was the same. Here's how it goes, right? You write up that node of the fork, you have a free act of will, undetermined by anything previously. You could go this way or that way. Freedom of spontaneity is consistent with determinism, so this is compatible, as they say. And I use determinism really just for something like causally explicable. This one is incompatible. Now the question is, and it's a really good one, is the challenge, so to speak, is to say, okay, so here's freedom of indifference. Now suppose I've got freedom of spontaneity. So I've got this one. And I read about freedom of indifference. And now I ask myself this question. So suppose I'm back in the bathroom and I say to the spirit, the voice, well, I see I've got freedom of spontaneity, but I want freedom of indifference. And the voice asks me now, not rather than granting my wish, the voice says, well, I have no idea how to give you that, but let me ask you a question in return. If I knew what I was supposed to do it, I would do it, but I don't know what to do it. But I'm going to ask you this. Why do you want that? Like, so why, now that you've got freedom of indifference, why do you want freedom of spontaneity? So, here are the two, right? And the question is, which is better, or, right? Okay, any thoughts on that? So, right, you can have whichever one you want. Which one should you want?
I feel like it seems like you would want freedom of indifference considering freedom of spontaneity requires you to examine discrepancies in order to get rid of them, right? Whereas freedom of indifference, you can avoid them.
But can't you run that the other way around and say, well, when you become aware of things that it's not good to want, right? Freedom of indifference, freedom of spontaneity, gives you a strategy for getting rid of them. Freedom of indifference doesn't, because it says, well, you can still do whatever anyway, so why worry about having one rather than the other, right? So this goes like this, right? So freedom of spontaneity says, okay, so you've discovered that you've got a desire to smoke, that's problematic, you want to get rid of it, here's some things you can do. You can get Nicorette gum, you can have antipathy therapy, you know, you can go to a place where there are no cigarettes. You know, it's a whole set of strategies. What strategy does freedom of spontaneity give you? It says, well, you're free all the time, so why don't you just say no? Now it's what it's going to do. So that's what lies behind the just say no response to drug addiction. Right? You're free, so why don't you just say no to it? And the thought is, yeah, well, he says, it doesn't work like that. Well, why? Well, because the little self that says no, right, the free little self, doesn't get causal efficacy from saying no. It doesn't actually affect whether the hand will move and stick the needle in my vein or whether I light up the cigarette. So in a way, it can seem like you really don't want it. Yeah, here's why, right? Freedom is not something we want an unlimited amount of. We actually don't want certain kinds of freedom. We want to be able to constrain ourselves, too. For example, we want to constrain ourselves to act on the best reasons, right? And so, in the same way, we are all the time. The idea that freedom is the great thing is, I think, an illusion. And we spend a lot of our time constraining our choices. And when our choices are unconstrained, they overwhelm us. And then it becomes a kind of unfreedom itself. So, favorite one, I can't do it anymore, but you know, just imagine you're going to the supermarket and you want to buy some detergent. And you go to the detergent lane, which stretches into the indefinite future with brightly colored, ugly packages smelling badly. And you, right, you're overwhelmed by, well, do you want it with fabric softener already in it? Do you want it to be fragrance-free? What about extra whitening brighteners? What about, it's terrible, right? You really just want there to be one kind, the good kind, and you just get it, right? And you don't have to waste your time reading a whole lot of crap about which detergent to use, right? That's the problem with freedom. It's not problem-free. You really do want to be able to make yourself, so this is the point of having a character, you want to be able to make yourself such that you will reliably do the good thing. And if you've got always freedom of indifference, it's not clear how you're supposed to do that. Right? All you can do if you're a cat is say, just keep applying the categorical imperative to your maxims, but that doesn't seem that it's going to be enough to get you what you want. Yeah?
So is the idea, like, if my freedom of spontaneity has wants, like, I only want to eat healthy food and I only want to be with partners based on their character, not their looks, whatever, then the idea is if I have that perfectly set up, I don't want any free will, basically, freedom of indifference, because I'll already be...
That's the way I look at it. If I get myself all set up so that now it will reliably do good, why would I want to add a chance? It would be like this. Now I've got it all set up. I'm going to toss a coin. That would seem like I've added a factor, but it doesn't seem like a good one.
Yeah, I think that... It seems like the question is, if I can do what I want already, what could freedom and indifference do? Anything except give me the freedom to do things I don't want to do.
That's a different way to do it. So here's the response to freedom of indifference, right? Why would I want to do otherwise, right? Why would it matter that I could have done otherwise if I would want to do the same? right? Notice that it would be absurd if I said, you know, when I do mathematics, I really want to get the right result. So when I give them 2 plus 2, I really want to get 4. And then someone says, yeah, but you know, you can set yourself up so that you'll, you know, you could get 5 too. Right? And you think, well, what? No, I want to get 4. So why would I want to add that dimension? Yeah.
I feel like the picture we're painting, though, like, makes it seem like freedom of indifference doesn't allow you to craft a motivational set. But you still can.
The point is, that's right, but then the point is, why do you need it in addition to what you've done over on your motivational set? So the thought is this, it's right. Yes. So I might say this. Okay, there's nothing to stop me working on my freedom of spontaneity, even though I've got freedom of indifference. And so what I can then say as I build more and more freedom of spontaneity, I can say, yeah, but you know, I really do like having that freedom of indifference too. Of course, I'll always act on my freedom of spontaneity. It's not the point of crafting the damn thing. But still, you know, I've got this little exit strategy sort of thing, right? And that's fine, but the question is, now I have to ask you why you want that. What does it do for you that you've got that as well? So it can sound awfully like this. So it's the explanation of how radio works. So, you know, how is it possible for there to be radio connection between Minsk and Pinsk? Well, here's how it's possible, right? So imagine there's a cat big enough that its tail is in Minsk and its head is in Pinsk. So when you step on its tail in Minsk, it screams in Pinsk. A radio is just like that without the cat. Says something weird about that explanation, right? And that's what's going on over here. Sort of like, well, I've actually got the cat, but I still want to imagine that radio operates, right, but without the cat. And that's just to add a layer of sort of magic to the picture. So you're not clear what it's doing. If the cat is there, what do I need the radio? I know how to get messages saying, what if step on the tail? Screams there. So that's the thought. It keeps asking, it keeps putting pressure on you to explain. Now, here's the explanation. Right? So what would Kant say if you told him this whole story? What explanation would he give? What would he tell you you should say?
So, it seems like the freedom of indifference, I don't actually know how connected this is with his categorical imperative, though, but that seems like a universal kind of decision-making format.
That's the thought is, all you can get out of the free will is whatever you can get out of something like the categorical. That's the only set of constraints that are on it. It's got to operate in an non-inconsistent way.
So you could behave inconsistently in freedom of spontaneity? I guess. I don't know. I think that might be his thing. It's like you don't want to act irrationally, and it lets you act irrationally if you have freedom of spontaneity.
It's not obvious, right? I mean, because after all, if any reasonable constraints, right? Anything that a reasonable person would want to build into their motivational set can be built into it, right? So if it were really true that the categorical imperative was the thing to build in, well, you'd build that in, right? You'd make it so that your motivational set passed the categorical imperative. Anything that can happen over here can happen over here, right? Except for the absence of causal constraint. That can't be built in. That's why the guy in the bathroom can't give it to you. Because he can't ensure that anything is going to be outside the causal order. Because nobody can ensure that. That's impossible to do that. That's the thought. Except maybe God. And actually, that's the right answer. I mean, it's really, I think what makes Kant think that this is really important is the idea that this is limited freedom. You know, how much freedom you've got is not settled, right? One person can have more freedom than another. Your motivational set may be such that it's just the one you would want if you knew everything and were reflecting clearly and blah, blah, blah. And mine isn't, right? So how much freedom does a person have depends a great deal on you know, what their motivational set actually is. And some people won't be very free at all. They'll be very unfree. Right? Well, that's not nice when it comes time for the judgment. Right? It's not true that we're all equally stand before the judgment, all equally in the position to follow or not follow the law. Some people will be such that their capacities to follow are quite small. Obviously true of psychopaths, right? They just can't follow it. Even we don't hold them to blame for it, right? But then we can move away from the psychopath. We're all kind of, to some degree, psychopathological, right? We've got little areas in which, and we don't know where they are, how much they are. So we don't know how to blame we are. So we don't know how much we should be punished or whatever. So this puts a whole big set of, it makes the traditional picture of us being all responsible for what we do and therefore all equally before the judgment, that puts that in. And then the other is that, right, it can seem, and maybe it's true, that there is going to be now a question. So suppose I get a goodwill, right, I get the one that I would want. But still, though, right, I get it because God gave it to me. Right? Then it seems like, and I think this is right, it seems like God is actually to blame for what it is I do as a result of the will he gave me. Why? Well, given that I have it, I can't do otherwise. Right, so now it becomes, right, now what I do flows from my character. Right, and my character flows from, right, the divine donation. And now it can look like I'm not to blame for anything that I do because, right, I couldn't have done otherwise.
So Nietzsche would say, tie that into the genealogy by saying that we're not free because our genealogy was a set of circles. Like, would he say that ultimate freedom would be ultimate freedom of your own genealogy?
Well, I think what Nietzsche thought is, it's we've got a project, which is to free ourselves, to make our will such that it's a free will, and that will, and to what degree we're successful at it, right? That stems from, just as in the case of the bird of prey, our actual strengths and weaknesses. It's not, there's nothing with any magic power to change anything, right? Strength is strength and weakness is weakness, and they will out, right? The idea is, can the circumstances be such that, right, the kinds of beings formed in it will have as much freedom of this sort as is good for them to have, or is consistent with, you know, their happiness and fully being alive, but there's no magic. They're not already formed there and waiting to be them. So remember that if it's deterministic, our attitude will not be one typically of reward and punishing. It's going to be one of diagnosis and treatment. We're going to want to know to what degree you were free and what we could do to help you and fix you. Now some people think, gee, that's just terrible. We want to be able to reward and punish. And Nietzsche's thought is, yeah, and we know where such people come from. Right? They're formed by the very story that we tell about the slaves and the masters. The urge to punish, right, and to torture and to do all of those things, is bottled up resentment manifesting itself in the world. People were, you know, hadn't been formed in this complex history, that desire wouldn't be there. We don't just arrive on the scene with our sense that rewarding and punishing is terribly important and we need to do it. We need to incarcerate, rather than we need to treat, reform, cure, finally just kill because there's no fixing. That's a different attitude, right? Yeah.
I can't remember when we talked about this.
Mm-hmm.
We talked about, like, in the final judgment day, mm-hmm. So like, if you do believe that people have different levels of freedom, then you get judged based on that individual level. So, like, somebody who has lots of freedom might get judged more harshly than somebody who doesn't have a lot.
Yeah.
So I guess even if you were given that at the beginning, like, then you get judged by how much you ended up accumulating over time.
Yeah, and I think the worry is then we go back to the old Plato, Aristotle, worry, right? Which is very few people are actually to blame for very much. Most people would be getting off. Why? They'd be getting off because actually their capacities for this kind of freedom are very, very small. Right? And so what you get out is, yeah, there's going to be an elite, but it's going to be small, that actually are going to be subject to some real, you know, judgment. The rest are just going to get a free ride. And that goes counter to the whole story about what incentivizes you, right, as an ordinary mortal, to be good, right? As you, again, you can think, well, I don't know, but chances are I'm really not going to meet the minimum requirement for getting shafted. Right? Okay, let's stop there. Next time we want to look at this question, right? How we got to be the kinds of beings who think about who are able to keep promises. So that we become, how do we become the sort of beings to which certain kinds of moral norms apply? Answer, we were always like that. There's something in us that's intrinsically subject to moral norms versus, no, it emerged, and here's a story about how it might emerge.